Welcome to the second part of our course in design fiction. My name is Mehmet Aydın Baytaş. I'm a postdoctoral researcher in interaction design at Chalmers University of Technology. And in this part of the course, I'm going to try and do my best to offer you some thoughts and resources about how to utilize fiction in design or for design. We will also be talking about design research. And now you might be thinking, why are we talking about research all of a sudden? Where did that come from? Hold that thought. We're going to come back to that later. So this part of the course is about fiction in design. This means that we will be talking about some questions that include the following. How does fiction fit in the process of design? How exactly can we describe the place of fiction in design, and what is some relevant language and concepts that we must know? How do design, fiction, and research fit together? And why are we talking about research at all here? Where did that come from? What is the purpose and value of using fiction in the design process? And exactly how can we use fiction to bring value in a process of design? What are some examples of this? Now, to begin to answer these questions, we have to first talk about design itself. What even is design? How do we define design? One way of approaching this question, which I find really helpful, is to think of design as having two aspects. It's like a coin with two sides. Because design in the real world, whether you're designing software or shoes or buildings or machines or clothes or whatever, it involves two classes of activities. On one hand, you have your user studies, your field work, your desk research and inspiration, mood boarding, observations, interviews, customer journey mapping, your post-its and notebooks and insights and ideas, all of this invisible work that goes into making design decisions. And on the other side, you have your illustrations and blueprints and 3D modeling, your photography, typography, woodworking, laser cutting, paper prototyping, coding, drawing, hammering, gluing. So design is both about picking problems and solving them. It's about making decisions and then executing on these decisions. There is thinking and crafting involved in design. The way that high-caliber design professionals and design leaders describe this dichotomy is by distinguishing between strategic design and tactical design. And you can very easily do this distinguishing between these two aspects of design by thinking about what is visible in the final product and what is not. In fact, this goes back to the legendary The Art of War, considered by many people to be one of the greatest business books ever written, where Sun Tzu distinguishes between strategy and tactics as follows. All men can see the tactics whereby I conquer, but what none can see is the strategy out of which victory is evolved. So tactical design involves the things that you can see in the final product. This is the shapes and the forms and the materials and the handiwork and the manufacturing and graphics. Strategic design is invisible to the consumer. Strategic design is the process of how you arrive at the decisions, which are then materialized and realized through your design tactics. The reason we're talking about this is that strategic design is intimately tied to design research. Now, if you think about it, ultimately, all of the decisions that you make as a designer can come from one of two places. They can come from your taste and your experience and inspirations. So this is your repertoire as a designer. This is the decisions that come from within. Or alternatively, your decisions can come from data, which is basically synonymous with research. This is your user studies and your interviews and observations and focus groups and workshops and all of those design activities. So research, understood very broadly, relates to the creation of knowledge. This is where you either sit at your desk or maybe you go out and venture into the real world and you acquire knowledge that will then inform your design decisions. So if your client or your colleague asks, you know, yo, this thing, let's get a thing, why did you design this thing in black? You can then say, well, I went out there and I interviewed 10 people that I think are really cool about colors, and they told me about their favorite colors. And so the results of this research show that black is a very cool color, maybe the coolest color, and thus this product that I designed is black. So research does not necessarily have to mean academic papers and scientific experiments and things like that. Research are knowledge finding and then basing your decisions on this data on this knowledge that you find is fundamental, it is essential and indispensable in design. Research simply means that you do the work that is necessary to find facts and information that will guide your design decisions. And then you can use these facts also to defend your design decisions if they are challenged by your clients or by your colleagues. So having established our definition and worth of design research, we can now get back to the topic of design fiction. So design fiction is very intimately tied to the strategic aspect of design and to design research. To understand the place, the value, the purpose, and the usage of design fiction within design, we need to contextualize fiction as situated within research and strategic design. First of all, to create and utilize design fiction is a strategic decision. If you look at the tactics that you employ to create design fiction, these are indistinguishable from the tactics that you use to create design that is not fiction. The writing skills that you would use to compose design fiction are the same ones that you would use to create use cases or stories or personas or specifications. The skills of sketching, modeling, making, crafting that you would utilize to create design fiction are the same ones that you would use to create designs for actual consumer products that are geared for mass production. Furthermore, if you think about it, all design on a tactical level is design fiction. By definition, all design involves creating something new. It's a product or app or service or something you're designing that does not already exist in the world as it is today. So as a designer, to explicitly frame your creation as design fiction is a strategic decision that you're making. You are basically saying, yo, this thing I'm proposing, I don't expect it will ever become real. I did not do this work to be mass produced, to be used, consumed, and understood as a garden variety product of the capitalist economy. This is fiction. It is not an actual product. And yet you still do the same tactical work to create this work of fiction. The essence of the work, the hands-on things that you do, are the same work that you would do for a regular design assignment. To spend your time in this manner, if you're a professional designer, it is an important strategic decision. And if you go back to thinking about a professional scenario, let's say you are a designer, an interaction designer, and you're working on an application for a bank, for example, they're expecting a smartphone application. In the context of this assignment, if you decide to consider a fictional world, fictional scenarios where, for example, you know, decentralized cryptocurrencies, which are not controlled by the state, are the norm, or the currency that you're spending, the currency that you have is intimately linked to the time that you spend in the world, or to some sort of like biological data or your biological well-being. This is a pretty huge decision. Those scenarios, those designs that you would create will probably not be appreciated by your clients who are expecting an app that will function in the world as it is today. So the decision to utilize design fiction in design work is not a decision to be made lightly. It is an important strategic decision. To be making this decision, you must know what value you are bringing to the design process by using fiction. What purpose is being served by using design fiction and fictional speculative artifacts? The answer to this question is related to the interplay of two subjects that are at the core of strategic design. One of them is research, and the other one is economics. Now, this is somewhat counterintuitive since we're speaking about, you know, creativity and art and fiction and speculation and critical thinking and all that. But actually, one reason we contextualize design fiction within strategy and research is economic. This has to do with how people find the resources and funding that is necessary to pursue design fiction projects. These are the resources to spend on the materials and the services you need to create these design fiction products, but also the resources to put food on your table while you're working on design fiction. So if you think back to the example of the professional designer working for the bank, or another situation where a professional designer is employed to create shoes or clothes or tableware or other objects, in these cases where professional designers are at work, they are expected to create for the real world as it is today. Professional designers are paid to create real products, not to create fiction. And of course, there are exceptions, which we will talk about briefly, but this is the norm. So the question is, if you do want to create design fiction, then where do you get the resources? Well, some designers will use their own resources, and then they will place their design fiction work alongside their professional design practice. Sometimes the fictional artistic design works serve to promote the professional business, so they serve a marketing function. And sometimes once these designers become more established and renowned for their work in design fiction, they might even be invited to create for specific occasions and sponsored by different organizations. So the details of how these collaborations and sponsorships take place are often very difficult to trace. However, I can give you one example. This is the project United Micro Kingdoms by Anthony Dunn and Fiona Rabbi, which was commissioned by the Design Museum in London. This is described in the final chapter of their book, Speculative Everything. What's interesting about this project here is that if you look at the scale, if you look at the craftsmanship that is involved in these products, the sheer scale of the project. So looking at the scale of this, you can see that this kind of project would not be feasible to complete within a reasonable time frame without having these necessary resources and sponsorship and support from an organization. So this is one way of how design fiction is created by professional designers. Now, if you would like to have a professional career creating or otherwise working with design fiction, there is another way to get resources for doing that. And that is to frame and position your design fiction work as research. Creating design fiction can actually be a form of design research. Design fiction can be a form of knowledge creation. Design fiction can be used to articulate and investigate research questions, not only within product design and interaction design and so on, but also in business, in social sciences, and a whole lot of other disciplines and fields. For this reason, you will find that a lot of people who actually work with design fiction are academic researchers. The resources that they need for their work and livelihood are provided by universities and research grants, and they deploy design fiction as a research strategy. So if you would like to have a career working with design fiction, this is possibly the clearest and most straightforward path to take. So this kind of work is associated with design and art most of the time, but it's also related to social sciences and critical theory. So if this is a path that you would like to explore, then familiarizing yourself with research and academic literature is a must. Finally, if you look at design fiction works from industry, and this is perhaps exemplified by these future vision videos or concept products, you will often see that the decision to create design fiction often again relates to business strategy and to creating knowledge that will inform business decisions. These projects are not done for the sake of art, or they are not just designers having fun. A great example of this is the future vision videos periodically created and published by Microsoft. These showcase various speculative future technologies and gadgets and practices. These concept videos are actually part of Microsoft's marketing and communication strategy. They deliver a specific signal to the viewer, which is, yo, we are innovators. We're working right now on these technologies and gadgets and cool things, and we are able to anticipate what technological possibilities and consumer desires will define our market in the coming 10, 20, 30, 50 years. Invest in us today. Buy our stock, buy our product. By making these investments now, you will have access to these visions that will unfold to provide value for you in the future. A second purpose for these creations is to gauge appeal and demand. The consumption and popularity of these speculative, conceptual, fictional works is monitored closely by the companies that create them. The feedback that they obtain through this work then informs the design and development of actual products. Now, there's actually one more reason why the topic of research comes up, and that is to enable your learning. So you may have already observed that in university courses, the materials you study sometimes come from research publications. And indeed, as part of this course, what we've done was to go out and study a few academic papers, and we created this content based on what is taught in these academic publications. So we use these materials to create these lectures, but we also offer some of this material to you to consume on your own time, and then we offer you platforms to discuss and compare and enhance your learning. When teaching and learning design, there's a very simple reason why we do this. The reason is that academic papers go to great lengths in describing the work that has been done in great detail. You will find in academic papers these minute details about the resources that they studied to inform their work, the exact procedures that they used to gather data, How many participants? Where did they find the participants? How did they select participants for their like workshops and user studies and focus groups and interviews? What materials they crafted with? What programming languages and packages and libraries they use? If you are a student of design or if you are a designer looking to improve your craft, all of this information is gold. All of this is the stuff you want to know so you can stand on the shoulders of giants, follow the best practices, emulate the work that inspires you. You can also be reasonably confident that the work being reported in academic publications is truthful and held to some sort of standard, since most academic publications undergo peer review. You simply do not find this level of information about commercial work. The only way you can obtain this level of information about work done in a commercial setting is to go and work for that company, become an intern or an employee of the company where the work is being done. Very few companies will publish case studies and reports about their design processes, and the ones that they do will report only very superficially on their work, especially compared to academic publications and the level reported therein. So for example, you can go to the website of IDEO, which is one of the most successful design companies in the world, and compare their case studies with what you find in academic papers. What you find is that the level of detail you find in a paper is just not there. Commercial design professionals will rarely take the time to write up detailed case studies, and often actually they are not even allowed because of intellectual property restrictions or non-disclosure agreements. So to sum up, in this part of the course, in this module, the goal is to introduce you to the usage of design fiction in design work. Specifically in this video, I argued that design fiction has the greatest potential to contribute to design work when it is contextualized in strategic design and design research. I offered you some arguments to support this position based on the expectations and economic considerations that are relevant for professional design and academic design research. I also offered you a final reason why the skill of consuming academic papers and being able to digest this information can carry you forward as a design professional. So in the next few videos, we're going to take a look at some specific resources that further explain and exemplify the place of design fiction in design research and professional design work.